Ross, who introduced me to all these wonderful occult or magical realms. When I came to this country, and eventually I got my first degree and second, and then I went to the PhD, I wanted to do something on the paranormal or parapsychology. And unfortunately, the head of the department wasn't very keen on the idea. And I got to the point where I was actually decided to leave. They pulled me back and they said, look, do something which is not too far off, and maybe you can put in your ideas in this book. So I got to start investigation in the book, which you know, the Hypnagogia. And you can see from the book that I'm leaning towards the ideas which I wanted to introduce to begin with. And eventually, after that book, came The Traveling Light, which gave me the freedom of saying what I wanted to say.
I see.
Is that long enough, or is it too short?
No, that was fine. That was fine. So now, let's focus in, really, into the incidents that initially took place in Traveling Light, because I have to say that you're a wonderfully evocative writer. You know, I very much felt I was really sharing your experiences that time. So if you can tell us a little bit about how that developed and take us a little bit through the book, how you describe it in the book and everything else, because it's quite, quite wonderful.
You're talking about the Traveling Lights now.
Yes.
Well, that we have to go back to the 60s. I used to go to Greece a lot from this country on holiday, and that's where I met this person, Yanis, quite accidentally, as I thought at the time. But as it turned out, it was much more organized on his part. I met the old guy who sounded a bit weird in his behavior and in the things he was saying to me. And it took me a while to realize what he was really up to. A person who had an enormous knowledge of the paranormal, a mystic himself. I know in the book I called him Shaman because of some of the things he said and did. But in fact, he was a mystic. And he cut across all kinds of mysticism, not Christian necessarily, but other areas. Well, short of going through the book in detail, I met him when I was holidaying. I was having a swim, and he just turned up. And things started from there. He shocked me to begin with because the language he used was quite peculiar. So I realized later on that it was a trick he used on me to get me out of my shell. And then, of course, once I found out what he was up to, I practically chased him around the island to find out what he was up to. And he led me to all kinds. Yes, he led me to all kinds of experiences.
Why do you think he chose you? What was it about you that made Yanis think that this young man is somebody that's worth developing?
I don't think that he chose me particularly. He's one of those people who, having mastered his art, and he knows who to pick on, so to speak, he just found me as one of those other people he was picking on, so to speak. I happened to be there. He somehow knew I was going to be there. So he thought, right, let's pick on this guy and open him up. By that I mean psychically. So there is nothing very, very specific about me. There are lots of other people similar to me in the sense of we're looking for the same things. So he's been going around the world doing similar things to other people. But because I had the background from Cyprus, I spent a lot of time with the Daskalos, as we called him, otherwise known as the Magus of Strobolos. And I gained some experience and had some background. He knew that it was time to sort of hit me, this psychic opening up.
Actually, in which case, can you tell us a little bit more about the Magus of Stroboroulos, please? Because I'm interested to know more, because you only touch upon him in the book. And he seems like a fascinating character. I mean, who was he? What did he do? You know, some just information about him, because I'm very keen. And I know our mutual friend Gary Lachman is also fascinated by this. So can you tell us a little bit about him and his background and everything?
Yes, he was a man who did not make his abilities, his spiritual and mystical abilities, as a means of earning a living. He used to work in a government printing office, which he did all of his life, but at the same time just practicing his arts of healing, mostly healing. That's what he said it was the most important thing as a spiritual leader to do. Healing is the most spiritual thing. So what he did, he slowly gathered people around him. Mainly these people came because they heard of him. He was practicing his healing, and through his healing, people heard about his work, and they started gathering around him. So he started forming groups of people. And these groups, there are basically three groups. The outside one, you couldn't even call them groups. They were just people coming in, listening to his lectures. And the other one, which he called the inner. There are people who was chosen. He then persisted in attending the lectures, and he decided that that particular person who attended a number of lectures, he was up to the right level, the right character. He would then invite them into the inner circle, in which one could spend a lot of time in meditation and pursuing spiritual aims, and then years later, which usually took quite a few years, if a person really developed spiritually and psychically, then he would take them into the innermost circle. And there are very, very few people who managed to get there. Now, all this time, through lectures and healing, he became very well known, mostly for his healing. People would come to him thinking that he would tell them their fortune, and he would play jokes on them and send them away, because that wasn't what he was there for. Healing as a spiritual art is what he was doing, and also through his teachings, he instructed people how to develop that ability psychically. It's a kind of overlap between the Indian system of the chakras and opening up the centers of energy, and a very serious Christian background. His teaching was Christian, but an esoteric Christian, if you know what I'm getting at. And the exercises were aiming to that direction. In other words, you know what I'm talking about, Christianity, like loving your neighbor, forgiving, and then if you're taking the Eastern side, it's controlling your thoughts, your emotions, the things that come into you without your control, controlling them. And he had a promise, a 7-part promise, which you have to give in order to become a member. And the promise is a different thing from an oath. You promise, in other words, you say, I'll do my best to stick to these things. An oath is a much more serious thing. So if you look at the 7 promises of what he called the White Brotherhood, unfortunately the word brotherhood doesn't cover the area properly in English, because in Greek that covers male and female. In English, unfortunately, you've got brotherhood and sisterhood. The word in Greek covers both. And in order to become a member, you need to give these 7 promises, which are, if you look at Pythagoras and his teachings, you'll find out there is a thing called the golden state of Pythagoras, and in it you find out these promises are exactly the same as the promises that one had to give. And they had to do with checking your thoughts, checking your emotions, making decisions not to stop and check what you're about to do, not do the wrong thing. And it got quite a lot of following all over the island, in various towns, to be cooks. Then he became internationally known. He started becoming internationally known somehow because of people coming. Oh, I remember one occasion I sat with him when he was dealing with people from Brazil and there are other people from all around the world. But then he became really when another Greek who is a professor at Maine University, he came to do a field work, to check to see what he was doing and follow him around. And when he published those books, he became really internationally known, and suddenly the coach was of people coming to see him. I was with him quite a while. Then I came to this country, I went back a few times to see him. That's very briefly with a man.
Wow. And what actually happened to him? Did he continue teaching? I mean, I presume he's not alive, he's not still alive. He's passed over.
Yeah, he passed over or passed away, whatever the expression is, in the 90s. I think it was 95. So that's quite a while back. But the work is being carried on there. People, his daughter is carrying on the work in Cyprus. There are also, I think, a couple of groups in Athens. There are groups in Japan. There are groups in the United States. There is a very big following in Switzerland and Germany, and I think in Italy as well. So it's carrying on.
And do the people that follow his work, do they follow his examples, or do they actually apply his ideas, his writings, his teachings? What do they do with that?
They do follow his teachings and the instructions. He wrote two books before he died. One is the Esoteric Teachings, and the companion to that is Esoteric Practice. So you have the teachings on one hand, and then how to practice the teachings, put them into everyday practice. So people who are interested, they will go to those books. He wrote other books as well. He wrote an enormous volume, which he called the Symbol of Life, which looks very similar to the Tree of Life.
Or the Kabbalah. Well, the Kabbalah Tree of Life.
Yes.
All right.
Yes, that's right. They're very similar, look, although the teachings behind them, they're slightly different. His contention is that he invented this Tree of Life, or he came across it in a past incarnation in Egypt. And the Kabbalah Tree of Life, it's a kind of adaptation of it. That is his contention. So people around the world who belong to these groups, they would follow their teachings, and the teachings are, I'll put it very briefly, there is, life is not just physical. There is life beyond the physical. So we're talking about a gradation of realities, if you like. You have the physical, which is interpenetrated by what he calls the etheric, which is a fine substance which sustains the physical body. These days people call it the energy body, and they give it all kinds of names, and even photographs in Kenya. Above that, what you call the psychic body, which is the body of emotions. Then above that you have the noetic, which is split into the lower, which contains thoughts of everyday life and desire and intentions. And then the higher noetic deals with abstract thoughts, similar to, not exactly, but similar to platonic forms and ideas. And above that, you have another area, which is much more abstract, which contains what you might call the permanent personality of a person, who incarnates and comes back again and again. and there are other gradations above that, beyond conceptualization. This is his system. And he also talks about the etheric, which he divides into aspects, some of which, there are four aspects. One of them has to do with the touching, the tactile side. Another one has to do with what he calls kinetic. So he's utilizing these aspects of the etheric, but he's actually performing. And I did see him once or twice performing and explaining what he's actually doing, using the etheric to perform healing act. What else can I say? I mean, it's very briefly. And he was capable, according to his contentions, to move out of his physical body into the etheric and beyond that to the psychic and noetic. And by doing that, he was able, and he actually did one or two experiments in that direction of getting out of all these bodies, one after the other. Because all these levels have their different bodies which embrace the physical. And by moving his consciousness away one after the other, then he will go into the substance, physical substance. Let's take, for instance, a piece of metal, like gold. He would enter it, enter consciousness, see and become one with the actual atomic structure of that metal. And then do the same thing with that with another metal, and then affect a change from one to the other. We're talking about alchemy, if you like. Mm-hmm. So we get into one substance, learn how it is internally, then copy that into the other one. And I remember one occasion when he did that experiment with his wife's. His wife had a silver ring, gold ring, a wedding ring, and changed it into silver. He got into trouble because he was very upset. He wanted to do something. Telling it to go. But eventually these things fall back into their true nature. So he said, not to worry, it will eventually, if I don't do anything, it will go back to where it was before. But he was using that as an example to test his own abilities.
So I'm intrigued as to how he acquired this knowledge himself. You intimated that he believed that he was a reincarnation of somebody from Egypt. Is that how he explained he came across this knowledge?
Well, he talked of a number of incarnations because it's not a matter of incarnating once, that's a lot. He had a number of incarnations in various countries, in Greece, in France, in South and North America, in Egypt a few times, in what is now Israel. And he was also, he said that he was incarnated as, or I think you call him in English, Origen, you know, one of the early fathers of Christianity.
Yes.
And before that, he had a number of incarnations in Egypt. So the knowledge he had from one to he's carrying the knowledge from one to the other. And you can say that that's how he got this, you know, from past incarnations.
Yes.
He also developed, in this country, in this life, he had to reawaken those abilities, which they came quite strong, actually, at a very early age.
Intriguing. One of the things that intrigues me about all this is the way in which a lot of the reading I'm doing now and a lot of the research for my next book, which will be on the pineal gland and the neurochemistry of the pineal gland and its relationship to certain neurotransmitters within the brain, is the way in which there seems to be and has been for centuries this belief that reality is, in the level we are at, it is coarse and it is solid. And then there are the gradations of solidity and of matter, which move by gradations from matter into light, in effect. And we, you know, in other words, what the famous British scientist Jean said when he said that in many ways matter is bottled light and light is unbottled matter. And in many ways, when I read your books and your experiences, both with Yanis and with the Magus, is very much this idea that this is exactly how matter and non-matter function. There are gradations of fineness, for want of a better term. You know, it's like gossamer, and it becomes less and less, and we can travel through these different esoteric levels. And of course, you know, I'm reminded of certain levels of theosophy, the teachings of Steiner, and many other people. These seem to be universals that are taught in so many different traditions. And of course, they don't necessarily fit in with modern science to a certain extent, but I would argue now with the discovery of stuff like the zero-point field, zero-point energy, dark matter, science is starting to now discover these by taking the blinkers off and starting to look at it in a subtly different way. Now, this is where your work is fascinating, because as a psychologist, you very much take an approach as a scientist, and you see these things as a scientist and apply the mystical side of things as well in this wonderful bringing together of these two traditions. So, was it then that you went off and you encountered Yanis? Was this after you had first come across, for the first time, the Magus' work? How did that come about? Can you explain a little bit more about that? Because I've always wondered, and it's something I'm sure that you do hint at the book, I've always wondered whether Yanis and the Magus were the same person, and whether he was playing games with you through your life or not. Because that's one of the things, you read the book, it reads like an adventure story, and it's like a mystery story, and that's what's so wonderful about it. And I'm really keen to just get that across, the wonderful narrative of the story. So focusing back, so what then took place in your life? What did you then do after you'd encountered the work, and what did you do then?
You're talking about Lazcanos or Yanis?
Either or both. I don't mind. Whichever route you want to take.
Well, with Lazcanos, as I said, he was the first. And the way I met him was very... people will call it a coincidence, but you know what happens with coincidences. They are not coincidences. I met Lazcanos when... at the age of about 16, I was very desperate with answers to questions which kept me awake and off my foot. At some point, that was during the war for independence in Cyprus. And I and my friends were involved to a certain degree, and circumstances brought us to meet this man who was running a newspaper where I sent some of my poems. Anyway, we met the man thinking that he was a traitor, so we threatened him. And it turned out that he was not a traitor, he was just a newspaper man. And when we actually met him, quite dramatically, he stopped us. And he turned us to the page he was looking at the paper when he was actually correcting it, and showed me that he was about to publish my poems. I mean, he didn't know anything about me, and I didn't know about him either. But it turned out that he was really with us in a way. And he said to me, look, I know you from your poems, you're very much into these things, and you're looking for answers, and the best way is to go to one of your teachers at the high school, and you will take it to this man, Daskalos, and he will give you answers to your questions. You know, you put it very, very briefly that way. And that's how I was taken to Daskalos when I met him. Things began to open up, and then I realized this is what I was looking for. This man has answers. That's how I met him. And then, of course, from there, things rolled on. But Yanis was different. I met him in Greece again. You can call it as an incident. It just happened accidentally. I was sitting in this little hole in a rock, resting, when he just turned up. And I thought that he was going to throw me out because it was his rock. And it turned out that he just, he faced me with a very sort of, in psychology, when there are various methods of putting somebody under hypnosis, and one of these is to throw somebody off their balance. And by throwing somebody off balance, their mind is it's not certain what's going on there. And at that point, just move in some kind of certainty. And after that, you're on. So he said something which was quite unpleasant, and that shook me out of my skin. And then he started doing some tricks with me, which actually I became very mixed up with my own psychology. And then that was his trick to break my everyday way of looking at things, my comfort zone, so to speak, so that he could bring in his own ideas. And of course, that was very much his teachings, very much like Daskalos, but with an added sarcastic attitude, which was quite pleasing. A great master, great master.
One of the things that really sticks in my mind in the book is when you have the first meeting with him. And as you say, the way he plays with you psychologically and pulls you here, there, and everywhere, and you're not sure what his motivations are, whether he's the owner of the land that the location is and everything else, and then you discover that this is not the case, and that he's an extremely interesting and eccentric gentleman that just seems to exist on the island, almost like a primeval spirit of the island in many ways. And again, from my many trips to the Greek islands, I recall madly trying to locate the geographical location so I could actually figure out which island it was. And when we first met, I was delighted to discover that I had got the right island. But it is wonderful how he then draws you in to his world. But then things start to get then very, very curious, don't they? He then starts to introduce you to some very, very deep concepts. And I don't want to rush ahead, but I'm always fascinated, you know, the Temple of Light incident, you know, where suddenly you're outside of your body and you're in this other place that you go to. Maybe to explain to the listeners how that took place and what the perceptions were that you actually had at that time.
That particular temple you're talking about, let's have to wind back a little bit. I was sent to meet this woman who was supposed to be his sister.
Yes.
And to my shock, when I was meandering around the streets and I practically gave up, and I was trying to avoid this dog who kept coming in, you know, in my path, which turned out to be a very interesting dog later on. Eventually, I got into the house and I met this old woman who was watering the plants. And when she turned round, it was Yanis, I thought. So I thought he was playing a joke on me. So I said, "You old scoundrel, you know, what are you doing?" And of course, he said, "No, I'm his twin sister." And you know, I was really shocked because I never expected that kind. Nobody said he was a twin sister. And when I was taken into the house and we sat down, had a drink of lemonade and sat on the veranda, that was a clever bit. He said, "Why don't you just sit on the veranda and watch the sunset?" Which was very nice, a good invitation. But then she said, "You know, when I was a child, I and Yanis used to do this little pleasant thing. You know, our parents taught us to do sit and look at the clouds and imagine things like kids do." And I said, "Well, this is nice, the sun is setting and so on." And slowly I found myself getting out of my body, traveling up with her. And she was giving me instructions. She was giving me a guided tour, or rather a guided visualization. And at some point, I lost her. and I was following the path which she was giving me the path, but I was doing it, and I could hear her voice afterwards, and then she disappeared altogether. And then eventually, through the sunset, a beautiful sunset, we got to this temple. Beautiful temple. Classical in a way, because it had columns, a few steps going up to it, but it was circular. Not the well-known rectangular Greek temples. It was had columns around, and it was until I got inside that I realized that the columns were not holding any roof. And then from above that, in the center of it, there was this light coming down, and music was pervading every corner of the place. And in the shadows, there began to appear different people, all kinds of nationalities, ages, back to old times, if you like, modern times, different clothes. And as they came to the middle of that structure, there was light coming from above, and you could see them. And the music started to lift us up. We moved into that light and were lifted up, which I thought would be going towards the ceiling, but there was no ceiling. It was just light coming down. It had the impression of a dome, but I couldn't see a dome. And the music, amazing. And then I began to lose my body. I had no body, it was just a shade of color. And at that point, I realized that Yana, the twin, wasn't there with me. And I, as a shade of color, was revolving around with the other shades of color. All these people became hue color. And were revolving around with the music, and every now and then I would lose my color. Somebody else. It was like, you know, in an orchestra, where you can play one instrument and then play another instrument. Or maybe if you are talented enough, you can change from baritone to tenor or something. But we moved around, and then eventually, and this could go on for quite a while. Then, of course, when I came back to it, I was still sitting on the veranda, and the old woman had gone inside the house. And that is an exercise in which I do practice. I'm cutting it very short, but that's the gist of it. The funny thing at the end is that Yana was not his sister. In fact, he's not had a twin sister. And that really threw me off. It was much later when I met him again, and I asked about your sister. I said, what sister? I said, what? Yana, your twin sister. About. I don't have a twin sister. I don't have a sister anyway. And eventually it turned out that people around who liked him, they started forming groups. They called each other brother and sister. And the guy who gave me the instructions to go and meet her, that's what he meant. But that was a tricky thing. But he played it so beautifully.
Absolutely, but what an amazing experience, you know, to find yourself in another place, another location that was clearly so real to you. You described it so beautifully there, and in the book you describe it even more vividly. And the idea that this is another location, another place, which there's a feeling of a mixture of light and sound, and overall sensations and feelings that are incredibly intense, almost, with the subject I'll touch on, we'll touch on in a second, almost synesthetic in the way in which you describe the sensations. You know, it's almost as if you're actually moving almost into a kind of semi-autistic worldview in the way you see it. Now, this then moves on, doesn't it? And you find there was this wonderful scene that you describe on the island with, was it the German couple, with the young girl who was ill? And how Yanni does some wonderful work with them. I mean, that's an amazing sequence.
Yes, you're talking about the Dutch family.
Correct, yes. Yeah, they were Dutch, yeah.
Well, obviously, the language didn't matter, but what was really peculiar And you see, all the way through the meeting with Yanis, he kept throwing me from one side to the other, from one place to the other, and when it came to time, concept of time, he really messed my head up because I couldn't find my bearings. I mean, I used to linear time, and he was turning me back, then he was overlapping with this, even with people he was doing that. There is a scene why he took me back to another incarnation, which we can talk in a minute if you like.
But yes,
the
please.
Scene with those people. Yes. The scene with those with that couple and their daughter. The really peculiar thing of that, which shows you that there are so many layers of experience. As I mentioned in the other book, Hypnagogia, I call them frames of reference. When I was with Daskalos years earlier, I experienced this event when we're sitting on the veranda of his house. Imagine it's nice summer, it's very comfortable in the evening, we're having a big coffee, and this couple come along, this couple with their daughter, and they were Greek, and they come in, and the daughter looked very, very down in the mouth. And they got into the room, they did whatever they did, and then when they came out, Daskalos explained to us what happened. And apparently the girl was suicidal. He tried a few times to kill herself. Eventually Daskalos took her back to previous incarnation. He explained to her a few things. He told her parents that about the doctors. They had gone to the doctors with problems with the girl, psychological problems, but it turned out she also had a cancer which they were not aware of at the time. All this story took place in Daskalos' place. But when I was on this little island, and I went up to see Daskalos, having swum from the mainland to the island, I saw this couple there with their daughter, and they are talking about the same things, the same words they are using in Daskalos' house. Now, Yanis was enacting the same scene, but they are talking in English. Being Dutch and him being whatever he was, they used English as a language. So I could hear them, but at the same time, I could hear the Greek version, which took place earlier. It was very sort of disconcerting. But I got into it in the end. The thing that was so strange was that everything that transpired in Daskalos' house years earlier, it was actually happening now on this island with this other couple. The same kind of incident. And the same results. It made me wonder, what am I? I mean, what is time here? I've witnessed this before in another language, in another location. Now it's happening again with another person, Yanis, and with the couple with their daughter. It's like a copy of it, but slightly different because they're different, different nationalities. That really messed up my time and space kind of, ideas.
Yeah, because that is not just, it's not like a deja vu sensation in the sense that you're experiencing something for the second time. It's kind of an overlap of a subtle change, and there's this temporal difference and an overlap of one incident with another incident, as if the time that they're actually happening concurrently with the same people and with different people in a different location using the same words and the same circumstances, which again is very intriguing because it must suddenly make you think, what exactly is reality here? You know, is time a mental construct, or is time something that I just perceive? And the reality is everything's a permanent present where everything is overwritten on itself. Because I very much, that particular section in the book really got home to me, the idea of both your confusion and your wonderment as to what was taking place to you at that time. And in the book, one of the things that intrigues me and I find very, very powerful is that there is the conflict, there's a conflict in yourself. You have your two friends that are on their island with you, and the way in which you're having a typical life of a young Greek guy. You clearly were not a Kamaki, but you could have been. And loving this kind of lifestyle that young Greek men for probably centuries have followed. So there was this kind of the young man inside you, but there was also this mystical events that were taking place. And all through the theme of it was the, as you intimated before, the dog. The way in which the dog kept appearing and everything else. And again, maybe if you can explain a little bit about that as well, because to me, that was, I know you don't like the term shamanistic, but it was almost as if that dog was some form of spirit guide. It was an entity that had an independence to itself. So maybe you can explain some of the incidents with that interesting canine.
Yes, that was something which was completely out of my comfort zone. I mean, everything that I did, Janusz did, was outside my comfort zone. But this one specifically threw me. I mean, earlier on, when I met him what I came to call in the end as a donut hole, because it's a hole in the rock, and I was there with him for quite a while, and then when I left him to go for the restaurant, I realized that there was no time for quiet. It was practically as if there's no time. So that was one, the first thing that I did, which he threw me, because I could not understand what time was, because time, as we know, I was looking at my watch and it was as if it stood still. Whereas from my point of view, things happened. Now that's the first thing. But now when it came to the dog, I like animals. I've never been particularly crazy about having pets. I've got nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with them. I like them. But this particular dog who kept following me, it was a weird dog because it has a bushy tail like a fox, peaky ears, and it didn't look like a normal dog. And of course, in the end, it turned out that it was more like a jackal. And when he turned up at the restaurant, and Yanis was taking out the bone out of his throat because he choked on the bone, he still didn't like me, this dog. He was sort of growling at me. And eventually when I managed to get him on his own, I mean Yanis, and we went up on a small hill and started talking, the animals turned up again. Now, I took him just a cross between a real animal and a kind of psychic counterpart of it, which appeared like the Anubis of the Egyptians, which Yanis called him Hermanubis. Hermes from Greek mythology, the god who guides the souls in the underworld. Also, you know, the messenger of the god. And Anubis was the one who weighs the souls after death. And that was something that came together, the Hermes and the Anubis. So eventually he was called Hermanubis. And that is, how do I put it? It's an actual entity, but it's a psychic entity. Whereas the dog was a physical animal, which I met a number of times. And up on the rock, up on the hill, he appeared again. And what was even stranger, he brought along with him another dog, who happens to be a female. And all kinds of jokes broke out there, because Yanis was making jokes about the dog being cynical, playing on the word sin, which in Greek means dog, and they are being very cynical about it. And he is talking about them getting together to make a family and so on. So there was a jokey side of it, but also he introduced another idea of the development of consciousness in animals, and specifically here of the dog, who is said to be. This dog wants to become man, becomes human. And behind that remark was the idea that there is a progress, there is an evolution in animals for higher consciousness. I did not go back in the book very clearly about human beings starting at the earlier time as plants and animals. Although I do give a little hints when I'm in the cave with that flower, which I felt internalized in my body, in my spine and my head, which reminded vaguely of Steiner, who talked about something similar. That life for a human being doesn't start when human beings came out of Africa. It's human consciousness starts much, much, much earlier, right at the beginning of creation or appearance of life, and evolves through plant life, through animals, and then up to the human beings as we have now. And there is a progress from that into what some people might call a god. But that needs explanation, what exactly we mean by that. So there is a progression, an evolution, from very simple life to much, much higher forms of consciousness. And we all partake of it. We can go back to previous sort of consciousness, which is an animal. Not in terms of incarnation. Incarnation, reincarnation, would not take us back to an animal. That's a peculiar idea. Once a person reaches the stage of becoming a human, it's ridiculous to go back to an animal. It doesn't benefit an expansion of consciousness. But with the dog there, the idea is that they have their own evolution. They will acquire eventually, I say eventually, we're talking about hundreds of thousands or perhaps millions of years of evolution. They go into, perhaps they may be able to talk, like we talk. But there is an evolutionary line. They will go to develop their own consciousness. And that's what that dog was playing on that hill. I was given the idea that dogs will develop like other animals in their own line of development, but also he kept taking me back to the fact that there is this Anubis idea behind it, which has to do with controlling your own nature, checking and developing your own consciousness as a human being. And that's why at the end he said, may or may not see him again, but he'll be within you, checking your actions.
Well, the more you're talking about this, the more I'm linking it to... I've recently read Graham Hancock's book, Supernatural. And in this, Graham talks in great detail about cave paintings throughout the millennia, right from the Neolithic times. And the symbolism of the cave paintings. And one of the things he discusses in some detail is the way in which, I think it's called anthereops. Oh, so it's animals that are turning into people and people that are turning into animals. And he's suggesting that this is to do with probably the taking of entheogen drugs, you know, certain mind-changing substances that allow the human brain, human consciousness to transcend its normal worldview, to see things in a different way. And it was only when you were talking then I kept thinking, of course, the dog there sounds very much like this kind of overall idea of the animal as a symbol. And then I was reminded of something else I'm working on at the moment, which is the idea of DNA itself being conscious. So in other words, we evolve, and we have evolved from the primeval slive in the Silurian seas. But effectively, what has carried through has been the DNA. And it's the DNA that's itself that has a form of intelligence that manifests itself within human beings, manifests itself within animals, manifests itself within plants. And indeed, you know, if you talk to the shamans in Latin America, they will argue that the plants themselves have a degree of sentience and they can communicate with them. So clearly that there are an awful lot of themes here that really can go into some fascinating areas. And, you know, I've just been madly making notes here of the things you've been saying because they're intriguing me so much. Because one of the other things that that Yanni did with you, which intrigued me, was I made a note where he says that Yanni discusses light a great deal. You know, and in page 304, he discusses how he lives on light, and he takes light through his chakras. He then lifts his hand and he touches his forehead. And again, one wonders whether Yanis was actually giving you some kind of signal there towards his pineal gland and the way in which light is manifest in the pineal gland. But before we move on to that, there was another section that I made notes about where it seems like your whole life flashed in front of your eyes backwards. Do you remember that sequence at all? I suppose you must. It must have burned in your memory.
Was that in the cave?
It was, yes. It was. Yeah, it was. Yes. He holds your head underwater. Do you remember? And you have this, you experience a whole life as a guy living in France in the 18th century. And if you recall that sequence.
Oh, right. Yes, that's not in the cave. That was well before that.
Okay.
That's right. That was taking me back to another life. And in fact, it was a life as a woman.
Yes.
Which was quite a shock at the time, because I did not expect that. Like many other things in the book, I didn't expect that.
Andreas, just quickly, the reason I thought it was calc was a cowman is that my typing on my iPad, I've spelt it C-W-O-M-A-N, and I meant it to be woman, and it was you living as a woman, so my apologies about that, yeah. Sorry. Please go on.
Well, not much difference.
Yeah.
What he did that, again, he was, I think just before that, he was giving me a lesson in sexuality, in gender, because he picked out a few things which I happen to be very keen on, or like everybody else, I suppose, being very young. One of them was sex, obviously. The other one was time, which you are all same with, and the space. So time, space, and sex, they seem to be floating around with me all the time very, very, very strongly. And throughout the book, he was actually hitting on all these things and trying to undo my way of looking at these things. First he started with the time in the hole. And it confused me, like, being with me in that hole in the rock for so long, and then clock time didn't change. And that's the beginning of that. It's carried on throughout the adventure. And the space, where do these things take place? A number of things which he took me through, they were spatial in a very peculiar way. They were there and they were not there. I mean, down in the gorge, he played about changing one substance to the other. Now, with the thing with the taking me back to being a woman, it was preceded by this business of sex, which came up in the conversation. He kept saying to me, "You're obsessed with this. You know, you keep up all the time." Something which he brought up again later. But anyway, he was trying to explain to me that the fact that you are a man now is just that, not quite an accident, but you are just born as a man, you have these experiences as a man, in order to expand your consciousness in one direction, but then you need to also look at the other side. And you're born as a man, then you're born as a woman, then you're born as a man again, a woman, and so on. You gain aspects of the way the other gender looks like. This is just one of the things. So in order to make me get into it and understand it, not simply understand it intellectually, but to also make me relive an experience as a woman so that I balance myself out, so I'm not just one-sided male, he played a trick on me by saying to me, look, let's see if we can have octopus in this shallow water. So I kept looking, and as I put my face close to the water, he pushed it under. And I was choking. I thought I was dying. And in that very short period of time, about seconds, I experienced the whole life. And it was interesting that as I was choking in that bit of water in the sea, I sort of came up in a bathtub in another life as a little girl. So the whole life developed from there as a girl, as a woman, who has lovers, who has a husband, and so on. And I experienced this from another angle, as a female. So when I came back, eventually, I started having a balanced view. I was reminded, I was reliving experiences as a different gender. So the idea of doing that for me was to stop me from talking about sex. You know, you're a man, you want certain things for sex. As a woman, you want something different from another angle. So don't make too much fuss about this. If that just happened, you happen to be a male or a female, it makes no difference. So stop going on about it. Sex has a much deeper meaning and a much deeper value, if you like. And then later on, when we are in the gorge, we go back to that because he knew I wasn't going to let go. So he said, right, we talk about this. And then that's when he sort of gets back into talking about sex and how sex, he asked me the question, is sex for procreation or for entertainment, for pleasure? And actually, at the end of the day, he overturns the whole thing. He says, you know, this procreation business is just a trick. If you did not have all this pleasure in sex, why would you, and he put it very bluntly, why would you fiddle around with another part of your body? which, as a man, you know, you have a piece of flesh down there, which has two things. You urinate and you have sex. You know, very, very important part of procreation. And yet, why does he put down there? It's like sort of pushing your face into, you know, excrements. He made this point in very, very, very clear terms. So he's trying to create a balance for me. Don't look at this the way you're looking at it, simply as procreation. That is a trick. If you did not have the pleasure, you would not bother to procreate. Which I'm sure many people, especially religious people, will have a strong reaction to it.
Yes.
He's demolishing it.
Yeah, because on that whole subject, I mean, as you know, my last book, I was dealing with time. The book that came out literally last week, The Labyrinth of Time, and in this I discuss the relativity of time and psychological time and the way in which time is different depending upon your moods. And I've been long intrigued by these, what friends of mine who lucid dream call the life dreams, the dreams that you live a whole life. And you experience a whole life, and then you wake up and you have this great feeling of loss because you realize that it's like dying almost, you know, that you've lived a life and then you die. And it's happened in a split second, but as far as you're concerned, you've experienced the whole thing. And I've had one or two of those in my life. And I know for a few days afterwards I was quite disassociated because I wasn't sure who I was anymore. Because, you know, the whole idea of who I am is ingrained within me. But I know for one few minutes in a dream sequence, I'd spent a whole life being somebody else. And that was fascinating and intriguing. When he then takes you, the next thing then, he then moves you on where you have the issue in the cave and you have the issue with the diamonds, seeing them in the air. And the huge iridescent egg that you see and the human figures from Greek history. Again, that again was one bit that I read three or four times because I found it absolutely amazing that you were encountering the embodiment of almost the Greek race within that cave, you know, the people right back to Homer. And you said something really intriguing then, and it's something I'd never thought of before, was that very much the writings of Homer, very much the Odyssey, is very much based on the journey of human consciousness. And I wonder if it was at this stage when you started to develop your interest in psychology as well. But I'm sure the listeners would be fascinated to hear now about the incident in the cave and how that then developed. Because that is a simple sensational description of opening up of consciousness, I think.
The thing with the cave, well, first of all, it started with getting into the cave through practically a slit in the rock. It was so narrow, I never imagined I could get through it. You couldn't get through it sideways. And when I tried, she said to me, no, you go down face. And of course, if you don't, it's a very narrow piece, and the water is running under me. Very little stream of water, but there it was. And if you go down facing the water, the shoulders are the wrong way, it should be sideways. I know, you do that, he said. And it was a practice. It was something what you train to get me through applying whatever knowledge I have of stopping the logical minds and using another method which would allow me to become part of the rock, so that my shoulders would slide through. That was an experience which I wouldn't have done it myself without his help, but it was his guiding through that rock. When I got in, the first thing, he was trying to show me how you can go back to knowing things, of learning about consciousness right from the beginning. And he gave me an example at the beginning of knowing through going back to the past, relearning. You have to remember, he said. And at the beginning I thought, remember what? I've never been to this place before. No, he says, remember, go back to remember. And then he went into the Greek language. In English, remember is to put things together, which is, he said, it's one way of actually calling up memory. But the other one, it comes out of a Greek word, which means to go within yourself to find the beginning. And that's the first way of him giving me an indication of how to know things. But once we got into the cave, sat down, that's where the magic began to be performed. First we had this stalk of flower. It's a stalk with a flower on top of it, which I had experienced before. I'd come across that imagery before, but this time it enlarged itself and it came straight towards me and became one with me, inside me. So the stalk itself, it was my spine, and the flower itself was my head, which took me back to this idea of starting as consciousness a long, long time ago, millions and millions of years ago, which also, I mean, obviously, you know, if you're a strict Darwinian, we can talk to Richard Dawkins, if you like, you will throw this away. But although there is no argument with the Darwinian evolution, I have no argument whatsoever. The thing that I think is missing there is that although you start from a very, very simple life, there is something else behind it, which is not visible, at least at that stage, at this stage of our evolution. Most people cannot see, but it can't be seen. There is a life which carries on from very, very early times. And that's the feeling I had when I saw that stalk become part of my spine and the flower in my head. And that took me back to evolution, how I started. Then we have the diamond egg. It's a very funny concept, but it's a diamond with the shape of an egg. Imagine an egg with the sides of it like doors all around it, you know, oblong pieces which like doors. And from those doors, then I began to get this kind of thing. Now, it's something which I hope I'll be able to do in the near future, to write a book about these ancient pre-Socratic philosophers who have been studied by Oxford and Cambridge and the United States. A lot of work has been gone into it. All we have from them are fragments and reports by other writers about their work. And because of the way we think these days in the West, they are taken according to what we have in front of us in terms of fragments. In other words, people are looking at their lives and their works purely from an intellectual point of view. Take, for instance, shall I say, Democritus with the atom. Or take, an earlier one, Thales, who came up with the ideas of magnets and so on. These are things which researchers are trying to find connections with other cultures. And many of the things that these people said, they are practically impossible to connect to other cultures. And my contention there is that through my intuitive research, these people were mystics. They came out of mystery schools. And many of the things they said, and of course Pythagoras is a very case in point, they came out with knowledge which they acquired in states of consciousness, which are not the ordinary kind of consciousness. They did not put two and two together. They did not work using the inductive method of science, so picking things together, putting one, two or three or four and a hundred things together in order to get to a general principle and a theory. They started from the top. They had this knowledge, this experience which they gained through their exercises. I can go on about this. I'm trying to see whether I can pick up to other things which are not too far off. Anaximander was one of the early ones. He actually is the first man who said that human life began in the water, in the seas, and life came out of the seas onto land. And this is on record because we have fragments of that. Now you can make whatever you like with that, but you can see now that it makes sense in modern way of looking at things. But he also said some other things which are really very strange. He said that everything started from what he calls, the Greek word is apeiron, which means indefinable, indefinite, something which you cannot describe, which sounds in many respects like, although he never used it, talking about life starting somewhere. And he said that life started from something which you cannot describe. And then the first step, and this is the interesting thing, is that it appeared from four principles: the hot, the cold, the dry, and the wet. Now, he went over it again and again, and these are adjectives. He did not say it started from something like an atom, for instance, or like Thalista from water, or from fire, as Heraclitus said. He said, he used these adjectives. And if you look at them very carefully, you find out adjectives are qualities. You're describing something as black or white or hard or soft, but then you're referring to a substantive, something. The table is hard and is dry and so on. But these are adjectives applied to an object, substantive, renown. But here he's not using adjectives. The reason he's using adjectives is because what is a noun? What is the thing? If you look at the table, in the last analysis, it's made up of qualities. You can only describe a table by using adjectives. When you take the adjectives away, nothing exists. It's gone. So he's using, in other words, he's using qualities. Like other Greeks of the time used things like water, earth, fire, air, which has a very special meaning, but not as actual things you can touch. You know, earth is not earth you can actually step on. It's the psychic aspect of it. So these things, and also if I can jump little forward, one of these guys, Empedocles in particular, he took me to this pyramid, which was made of four sides, which were basically colors, nothing else, but just colors, energies, if you like, in color, which inundated me. And this is what this other guy, Anaximander, said, that we have qualities which are not substantives, but they are not describing anything. They are not describing substance. Now, you try and make sense of that. You cannot make sense of it on the three-dimensional world we live in. There are vibrations, energies which lie behind anything which we see as matter. After all, in modern science, we know that anything which has mass can turn into energy, and vice versa. So he's talking about energy, qualities which at the beginning of the world, which then at some point when you and I acquire the right senses like sight and touch and so on, we can see them as having mass. But when you've taken away your senses, they don't have any mass. They're just qualities. They come together, they give you mass. And then you call that table, chair, whatever you like. So this guy is talking about things which they're not things. I mean, it's a very difficult concept to come to grips. And how would anybody come along with such ideas when there was nothing at the time by way of scientific investigation? Some of these guys were called the first scientists, but not in the modern sense. They did not do experiments. Some of them collected fossils, and they observed the world around them. But they did not have the equipment and the technology we have today to do these things. I know Pythagoras, who said that the earth is round, it's spherical. How on earth? How could you decide that the earth is spherical? 300 years after him, another guy in the 3rd century BC, Anaximandros of Samos again, he worked out, he said that the earth is not the center of our universe. And in fact, the earth is not flat, it's round. It's not the center. The center is the sun. He came across with the first idea of the heliocentric idea, the solar system. The sun is in the center, all the planets revolve around it. Now, what happened to that idea? It was so weird, nobody wanted to bother with it. Something like nearly 2,000 years later, you get guys, you know, in Europe, who actually observe the same thing, and they say, and now we know what they are. Now, they didn't have equipment. How did they come about these things? And I can multiply this a number of times to see what they could have. And they're also known as healers, magicians, if you like. They performed what you might call miracles. Some of the things that people ascribe to Christ, they're already in the history referred to Pythagoras having done the same things. You begin to wonder who they were, and you either dismiss them as fantasy or you investigate them.
I think
right now the only investigation.
I think that the work you're doing and the way you're moving towards work on the pre-Socratics is indeed fascinating, because when I came across the individuals you were discussing, I first came across their work when I read Arthur Koestler's book, and I can't remember the name of it now, particularly because I've read a lot of Koestler's work. But I, funnily enough, I have my own little story about that, because I curiously found myself quite by accident in 1984 in Miletus, which was, and I didn't know it at the time, was the city where Thales and Anaximander and many of the other of these pre-Socratics actually lived. You know, it was very much in Asia Minor, wasn't it? It wasn't in Greek Greece proper. It was very much the Asia Minor. It was the coastline of Anatolia that these guys actually had their locations and cities. And I've been long intrigued, like you, about the sources of their knowledge, you know, because they, as you said, they were not they didn't have scientific equipment. It's as if they were actually going inwardly to draw out this information in some way. And I was wondering, and I know you, I think you touch upon this in your books as well, is the Eleusinian mysteries, the way in which they used certain hallucinogenic substances to touch the noetic, to be somewhere else. And I can't recall the name of the drink. There was some kind of drink they had, which is like soma, which is the Indo-European and the Indian drink that is mentioned in the Vedanta, where they were able to go into alternate states of consciousness. And I suspect that what was happening was that, as you quite rightly say, they were going into these states of consciousness, going inwardly, not intellectualizing about them, but actually getting closer to the information by going inward. And it's something that in my books I'm now moving to. It's something I call the intramatic experience. Now, your work is very much, and I'm very keen to know more about this, because clearly there is something very intriguing, and that it's a mysterious part of history. You know, these guys knew their stuff, you know, the Pythagoreans and all that group. You know, there's something very, very mysterious and strange about them. And I'm sure that, as you said, we've got piecemeal information about them. You know, we've only got snapshots. We've got an awful lot of it in secondary sources. Some of it's been written by people that were pro or anti those individuals as well. And there's this whole area of missing history that we have. There's lost knowledge, the hermetic knowledge, that clearly is. And I think individuals like Yanis have attune into that. And I know it's me being overly romantic and being a sort of a lover of Greece, but I feel that you somehow get that feeling in the Greek world. Even now, there is kind of a touching of something very, very deep and meaningful that happens in the Hellenic world, I think. So you had all these wonderful experiences and fantastic. For instance, one of the things you have this encounter with the Kouros, the Apollo figure as well. So in that time in the cave, you had some amazing, amazing experiences that would probably change people's lives. And I just wonder whether, you know, this brought you then to the work that you are most famous for, which is your work on hypnagogia and hypnopompia. So can you explain, after all these experiences, how you then became Dr. Andreas Mavromatis, psychologist? How did this all come about? And if you can then move on a little bit into your ideas and hypotheses about the true nature of consciousness and the hypnagogic experience.
Yes, okay. Obviously, as you said at the beginning, these things dovetail. Because of my early experiences in Cyprus and in Greece, I've always been interested in psychology and philosophy and the mystical aspect of these things. So when it came to applying for a postgraduate degree, I was offered this place at Brunel University, and my proposal was to do research on what is generally known as the parapsychological part of psychology. I don't like the parapsychology word. It's anything we are not sure about, we stick a para in front of it. But anyway, that's they call it parapsychology, they call it the abnormal or whatever. But I just wrote the piece and I said, right, at the very first meeting we had as PhD students, I stood up and talked about it like everybody else does when my turn came. And I said, this is how I laid it out, the way I wanted to carry out with the research and so on. And the seminar was headed by the head of the department, who then made a sarcastic remark. He said to me, what, you want to do your PhD on what my grandmother talks about little fairies at the bottom of the garden? So I stood up and I said, look, I'm not staying here any longer. So I walked out and I had decided that that was it. I was not going to agree. And it took a while on the part of my girlfriend to pull me back again, promising that, look, we got this thing about the hypnagogic images and so on. Maybe you can do some work here and then get your ideas in and so on, which I did in the end. But unbeknown to me at the time, when I walked out, the setting of the seminars, which was monthly events, collapsed completely because all the other students walked out as well because they found that reaction really bad. Eventually, I was taken back. You know, I actually threw in the it was silly of me to do that at that time. You know, I was offered a grant to do it. But eventually, my tutor put me back and said, let's do this. So I got into this, and then I looked at it, and he said to me, go away, look at it, and see if you can do something with that. So this is what I did, and then I thought, well, I can do the research, and I can see lines of inquiry which can take me to the areas of my experience. And that's how I started. And of course, it was a PhD degree. I had to do it scientifically. Whereas the traveling light, I did not bother these things. You take your limits. But with that book, it had to be serious in the sense of being scientific, providing evidence, setting up theories, and the usual kinds of things. And that's how we got into it. Because the more I got into it, the more I had the common grounds with my interest.
Well, I have to say that the book Hypnagogia is a magnificent work. You know, there is no question that so many people in my reading and my research reference it. You know, that there are so many people of my generation that are heavily influenced by your work. And I think it's because your approach was so refreshing, because even it was clear, even in the book Hypnagogia, that you were willing to accommodate differing viewpoints, even though it is a rigorously scientific piece of work, it still showed a willingness to actually say, well, you know, I'm not being materialist reductionist here. I'm not falling into the trap of assuming that consciousness is literally just an epiphenomenon of the brain. And it is something more than that. You know, there is an inner life. You know, I'm very much, you know, the work of people like Daniel Dennis and the Churchlands, where they say there is no inner life. They deny the fact, you know, the reductionist materialist, reductive materialists. Whereas clearly there is something more going on. And that's what was so wonderful about your book. But on top of that, the way you describe a very, very common experience. And what intrigued me was, and I suppose I was semi-surprised to discover, but in many ways not, that the term hypnagogia was Alfred Mowry, wasn't it? I think that first came across the concept of hypnagogia as an idea. But this is something that everybody experiences. You know, I will guarantee that even the members of the audience that are listening in here now, or the people that will be listening to this on the recording, even if you don't know what hypnagogia is, when we explain it to you, you'll recognize it. So, Andreas, if you can just explain to the guys out there exactly what is hypnagogia and exactly what you think is happening.
The term hypnagogia, I chose that for the practical reasons. I mean, the adjective hypnagogic was already coined by Maury, a French psychologist back in the middle of the 19th century. And there are lots of other terms that were proposed by a number of people. I would read some of them because it's quite fun to see how many of these things were used at the time. I look at the book and then look at the beginning and give you a few of this terminology. Hypnagogic, it's from hypnos, which means sleep in Greek, and agoges, which means leader or guide. So it's leading into sleep. But then, of course, you have the other problem on the other side when you're waking up, and another guy came along and used the word hypnopompic, which means coming out of sleep, which are very awkward. I use them in the book, but only for to pick out the temporal sequence, whether it's the beginning or sleep or the other end. But other people came up with things like, let me see, we're talking about the phenomenon, visions of half sleep, insomnial or anhypnic sensations, or oniragogic images, phantasmata, faces in the dark. And then, of course, you got things like hypnagogic states, the state itself, or borderland states, sleepening states, half-dream states, threat of medium, sleep onset, falling asleep, and then you get the German Einschlafen, and then endomisedman, that's a French one, Atormentamento, and there's a lovely Italian word which I started to use, which covers both sides. Dormivelia. Dormi from sleeping, awake, and I think it's a lovely one, dormivelia. Mm-hmm. I played with that, so I thought, shall I use it or shall I not? And then I thought, well, the hypnagogic is already in the literature. So let's turn that into noun, hypnagogia, and use it throughout. And then whenever we're talking about the waking up, it's, okay, I can bring it upon the clarity of definition. So it is falling asleep and the waking up. And it's such an enormous area, it covers so many experiences. And my task was not only to research it, but to make sense of all these phenomena. And at the end of the day, I realized that these are stages of consciousness. When you're relaxed, you're going to fall asleep. Usually, I use the word advisedly because sometimes slightly different. You get little sparks, clouds of color, and then maybe a few sceneries crop up, and then faces. They don't always follow that pattern, but that's the usual kind of thing. And when I was doing the research, I realized that these were dependent, and there are lots of other phenomena, like what they call the auto-symbolic phenomenon, when you see in terms of picture the effort of concentration you're putting into it. It's as if I'm falling asleep, and I want to stay on that borderline of making an effort. They get the picture, which is a symbol of my effort, like a picture I have in the book where somebody running towards the door and the door is receding, not able to get there. Or one of my own images, like a mountain, like the Sisyphus story of about this stone which was trying to get to the top and rolling around and keeps falling down and I keep pushing it because I'm trying to sustain that state consciousness. And I'm being pulled and pushed. One of them says fall asleep, which is a continuation of it. And the other one is the wakeful consciousness. And the balance, the effort to keep this balance going on, it gives you a picture. And it's called, I think, an early researcher called Silberer, the beginning of the 20th century. He came up with the auto-symbolic, because it tells you the symbolic form of what is happening. But it's a range of these. And I found that it was all based on how far you are involved in the experience. So it's a matter of the investment of consciousness. Earlier on, when you're just lying down and relaxing, you get those very small sparks of energy, clouds. Usually clouds come very early, or color, and then faces move. It's beautiful scenery. And then it may develop into, if you're not careful, then it develops into a dream and you're lost. And people can be trained to hold on to that. And this is one of the breakthroughs I had when I realized that people could actually dream at that point. And that went against the research at the time, which showed that you don't dream until you get into REM state much later. So in the non-REM state, you're having dreams. Now, the literature showed that if you have dreams in non-REM state, but these dreams are more taken up by your daily occupations, what your concerns and so on. So you are actually talking to yourself, having arguments with yourself, so you are not really dreaming properly. But now, I found out that a person can actually have four dreams in this non-REM state. The problem came up that the definition of a dream is that you lose consciousness of the situation, you know, the physical situation around you, so you're in it and you're hallucinating in a way. And also you're playing the leading part. Whereas in these hypnagogic images, you are an observer, which is most of the time, but you can actually get into the dream, you can dream, and you can be conscious of your physical environment, which is actually, I found that very pleasing, because it threw me literally into the area I knew about telepathy and clairvoyance, where you're actually experiencing similar things, but you're fully awake. You are in a kind of slightly dream state, but you are not in a dream. That's one of the first things that came. The other thing was the philosophical aspect of it. Philosophers were thinking that in order to dream, you must fall asleep. And usually people associate them that way. Fall asleep when you dream. You can't pass the dream when you're awake. It just doesn't work. It's by definition, you have to fall asleep when you dream. But how come you are in a hypnagogic state, you are having dreams, and you're awake, and you have experiencing a dream, and you're aware that it's a dream. You know it's not transpiring around you. It's in your imaginary space. So the problem of philosophical premise that you must fall asleep in order to dream. And then if you dream, you fall asleep in order to dream, but when you fall asleep, you're unconscious. Which makes sense. You're not conscious because you're asleep. So if you are saying that I fall asleep and then I dream, that means that you're having a dream when you're unconscious. So you're making a statement about something which cannot possibly take place because you're unconscious.
Yes.
You're talking about something which you experience when you're unconscious. Doesn't make sense.
It doesn't, for that reason.
But that's the logic of the philosophy, because philosophy, unfortunately, with all the great, I got 2 degrees in philosophy, so I love philosophy, but it needs premises to start with. So if a scientist pushes the barriers of knowledge and gives you certain data, then as a philosopher, you take that as granted, and then from that, as major premises, you make your logical steps and your conclusions. But if the premises are not right, and in this case they are not correct, they are invalid, because they are based on assumptions. They are not true. I know that I can dream while I'm awake, therefore I don't have to fall asleep. So the whole premise, the major premise, was the position. So it's the philosophical aspects really waste time with. Experiential. So you can dream, you're conscious. And of course, once you get into that area, you can move into other areas which are similar. When you say dream and be conscious in your dream, then you get into lucid dreaming. Now, lucid dreaming for many people seems to be an idea that came up very long ago, you know, in recent years. In fact, if you read Aristotle, the big about sleep, he talks about both the hypnagogic dreams. He says that if you watch out while you are drifting into sleep, you catch lots of images developing into the dream. In another part, he says that when you're actually dreaming, there sometimes appears a sense in you which tells you that this is a dream. This is lucid dreaming. You know, one aspect of the dream is to be lucid, to be awake, that here I am dreaming, as opposed to being part of the dream and you are not conscious you are dreaming. So these are things which are very important in the sense of telling us that you can progress to a deeper stage, attain consciousness from the early stages of Himalaya. But as the research progressed, I found out that lots of these things, they are also common with other experiences. If you do your job properly in, say, developing psychic abilities like and clairvoyance, you find out that you do the same thing when you're awake. I mean, you don't fall asleep to clairvoyance, but if you ask a clairvoyant person, a medium, tell you what they are experiencing, you see that they are shifting. It's a matter of consciousness, shifting into another realm of reality. They are conscious they're shifting into that. They are not relinquishing the physical side. They are conscious of it because they are talking to people. Unless they're doing it by themselves. If they are talking to people, they have the consciousness of where they are, but they are also conscious of another reality. I thought, wait a minute, this is, I've had experiences along those lines, and I can have them when I'm drifting off to sleep. I can have them when I'm asleep, or rather when I'm dreaming. And also when I relax and shift my mode. Then I thought, wait a minute, let's watch out, because it's a matter of investigating the modus operandi, what is actually happening. But you can only do it from within when you actually put yourself in the experience itself, not just listen, but put yourself. Find out that there are layers of this experience, layers and layers, what I call the frames of reference. And they are all. They may be taking place at the same time, or they may be a graded kind of stage where you move from one to the other. In hypnagogia, they grade, but you can have them all together at a deeper stage. So I thought, this is what one can do. If you're doing a very simple exercise which is called psychometry, picking up an image. This is not a term which is used in psychology. This is a term used by psychics. Picking up an image, an object that belongs to somebody, like a ring, a finger ring, or a chain or something. You hold it. What you do, you relax over it. In other words, shifting your attention, which attention is receptive. It is not a forced attention, like you're forcing your attention when you're literally crossing the roads and you're looking left and right. It's an attention which is a very relaxed attention. I call it a passive receptive attention. So you are switching into that, shifting yourself into that, while you are not completely relinquishing the physical side. And when you're doing that, you're moving yourself into another frame of reference in terms of consciousness. And you're picking up images, feelings, sensations, which you know yourself they are not yours, because you know enough about yourself to see that they don't belong to you. It takes a little practice. So I thought, wait a minute, this is what one can do in psychometry. I joined a number of groups of spiritualist groups in order to investigate that. And I got involved as a participant. And then I saw that they're the same. Of course, I had some similar experiences a long time before with those courses. But now, because I was doing the scientific research, I had to have recourse to evidence in order to talk about these things, which is not just my experiences. So I found out that's happening with psychics. Then I looked into the literature of meditation, and also meditation I was already practicing myself, and I said, wait a minute, we have similar things here. So basically the beginning of hypnagogia, which means you relax physically, you relax mentally, you do not occupy yourself with the physical environment, with your own problems and so on, because unless you do that, you're not going to have it. You need to relax. It's a natural process. So these things are also found in psychic activities, you know, clairvoyance and psychometry. And they are also part of the beginning of meditation. Also experiments in generally sight, period, experiments they carried on in the 60s and 70s, quite a lot of those. They have the same components. So I began to see that these areas which were kept separate, they are not that separate. They overlap a great deal. So if I started with hypnagogia, if I identified some of the characteristics of hypnagogia, I found them in all these other experiences. People are sitting around meditating, in the East. And in a monastery, you have them sitting around relaxing and meditating. And behind them, walking behind them, you have a master, guru, around with a stick in his hand, and if somebody knocks his head, they hit him on the head to wake him up. Because it's a natural, if you're not careful, you fall asleep. You have to hold on to it. So we come to the point where hypnagogia as a process, natural process, will take you to sleep. Dreaming sometimes before sleep onset. But these are natural things. Now, if you learn to hold back and stop yourself from falling asleep, then what is the difference between that and the early stages of meditation, psi, raw nature, psychometry and telepathy and clairvoyance? The early stages are exactly the same. So that was great for me because I could see now I can link with my other earlier experiences from that skeleton, Dennis, and so on. And then I thought, wait a minute, this is scientific research. I need to look into the brain activity, see if I can connect, find any evidence there. And, of course, if you look in the literature, you find out lots and lots and lots of evidence of what goes on inside the brain. First, with the electrodes that are attached to the brain, the EEG, how the frequency changes, the spikes change. Things like alpha and theta, as we relax, if you fire a person with performing, say, some psychic act, you find out they drop down seven cycles per second. Wait a minute, that's falling asleep, nearly falling asleep. Again. So we have evidence in that direction. And then I looked into the literature and to see whether images are formed in the eye, because there's some literature saying that everything is in the eye. Because if you look with your eyes open, you find all kinds of lights coming up, specks of lights, images forming and so on. And then they're abstract, they're lines and circles. Then if a person concentrates, they can build up from that. But then I found that it is not possible because sometimes you have fully formed images. You cannot really go back to the pieces. So it isn't really in the eye. Now let's go further back. Where is it? We call all the pathway to the visual cortex. Now, is it there? I mean, visual cortex, that's what we see, literally, and then, without that, we can't see. And then I looked it into more carefully, and I said, wait a minute, there are experiments where, for instance, one occasion, a person is sitting watching television in the lab, she's watching television, and while she's doing that, it's wired up, you can see the response in the visual cortex, which is natural. You can see the response in the eyes as the images hit the retina, and then the visual cortex picking it up. And now she was asked to visualize as clearly as possible her daughter. So create a vision of her daughter in front of her. And there was no... Obviously, the light was falling from the television set, was still falling on the eyes, so they could register the images falling on the retina. But there was nothing at the visual cortex. Now, we're having a problem with the transmission there. Should I carry on? Anyway, the result is that if it's not on the visual, we lost a bit there. If it's not in the eye, we decided that. Now we can see that it's not in the visual cortex. The image the pictures from the television do not reach the visual cortex anymore, because the woman imposed between the television and the eye the vision of a daughter, an imaginary vision. So it's not going to the visual cortex. Now, where is it? So more research found that I went down to the middle brain, the limbic system, and even further down to the, you know, the old brain. And then I went there, and then at the same time I looked at hypnagogia and the experiences of visual, auditory, and very other sensory experiences, and I realized that these things are really guided by the whole brain. Then you have to look into animals, in other words, the genetic part of it, how they actually develop their way of perceiving the environment, and so on. And then I found out that a lot of these things that we're talking about in hypnagogia, the psi and psychic, and I left out the most important thing, the creative part. Creative people fall back on these things, which are sometimes mortal. If you look at Einstein, he's talking about these things. Einstein is supposed to be, you know, abstract intellect. He's not. He's actually employing the motor sensor part of his imagery to understand and convey his ideas. We have lots of other people, very creative individuals. Arts, of course, we've got pictures of Dali in there. He used the method. The very famous Kekulé, the chemist, who came up with a benzene molecule. That's an image. And then you got Faraday with ideas. And what was intriguing there is that these people were using aspects of their brain which was not, it was not the cerebral part. It was something below that, because they are using what some people at the time called older forms of seeing our brain. They were not that old, because they're using them in their work in order to understand and convey their ideas, which are very abstract. The Kekulé is a very good example. He was trying to understand the benzene molecule. He couldn't. He was doing it the way they were doing it so far, which was linear. And, once he was sitting on the bus going down to Clapham in London, he saw all these snakes falling around his head, and they are little balls and so on, and he couldn't make sense of it. And years later, he was sitting in his sitting room by the fire, and the same thing happened. And he was drowsing, and he was dropping off. He saw this snake biting its own tail, and it's creating a circle. Instead of being linear, it was now, it was circular. So then he got up after that, and sat down and worked out that this is the benzene molecule. And the way he actually put it down, when the benzene molecule was seen under a powerful microscope, it's exactly what you're seeing. Minus the tail of the snake and all that, but these are the little joining together. With Faraday, he was talking about those energies, which now, with Curly and photograph, we see exactly what he's talking about. Another scientist was talking about falling asleep. That sort of hypnagogic state is experiencing what looked very much like the brain. Well, then he was familiar with that. He says, it was there in front of me when I was falling asleep. What I'm getting at here is that in that state, actually, some of the experiences are imaginable. Some of them, they are not. It's like you're seeing under a microscope some of these things. So again, we are drifted back into psychic things. How on earth do you see things? Which they are not really, you are not normally able to see. How do you see the shape you actually see? And then you find out that it's exactly the same thing in reality. Some people, because of the state you are in, you've got frames of references which are crossing. It's a matter of appreciating one and the other and how they cross. Sometimes they cross in a way which is crazy. And this is, again, another part of the book where schizophrenic mentation comes in, which is very similar, because they have no control over their frames of reference. So you get all these weird things coming on. One of them came up only Ford and Henry Ford have no umbilical cord. That's what I thought. Funny. But that was in their schizophrenic side. But at the same time, you have Einstein saying, sometimes what makes me hazy, am I or everybody else crazy? See, if you are in that, if you are looking at things from another angle, from another frame of reference, and if that frame of reference doesn't fit with the way everybody else is comfortable with, you are either crazy or, in these cases, am I crazy or everybody else is crazy? Now, I can go on and on with that kind of thing, and with the brain activities, slowly I found out that parts of the brain, especially the limbic system, and the lower part, down to the medulla oblongata, I found that lots of the experiences can only be put down to those activities and not to the, to the neocortex, which we use, you know, for working out problems and so on. I had to face the problem of hemispheric lateralization. You have left and right hemispheres, and usually we say the right, that's for the artistic, or the uniting of things, putting them together, whereas the left is more mathematical and literal and so on. But then, again, the evidence in the literature and the experience doesn't actually support it very well, because you have cases where you have a defect in the left hemisphere and the right rotates over. You know, there's a lot of plasticity really in the brain. And this is actually the way I started by pulling back slowly into the lower parts of the brain. And that's where I place, if there is any contact on the physical level of consciousness, I think we have to look for it down there. And of course the pineal, as you are very interested in that now, it's a center which will probably hold a lot of information for us. I mean, Descartes was one of the ones who actually brought it out very strongly. By the way, Descartes had a few hypnagogic experiences. In this case, they were hypnagogic because of having a dream, waking up, having impressions and intuitions, and then going back again. Three times he did that in order to come up with a wonderful idea that all the science is coming together as one. Is what science is doing now, trying to find one unifying science which explains everything. And of course, if we find that, we have to argue against people but, because this one theory that explains everything, one particle which is the basis of everything, where do we stand in terms of arguing for science or theology? I begin to feel that one thing that explains everything is what people came up to begin with, who believe in God, and now scientists are doing the same thing, but it's not God, it's something else. These are names. I don't care whether you call it God or the unique part.
Wow, all I can say, Andreas, is that was incredible. I'm aware of our time because we're about to run out of time now. But that was an enthralling 25 minutes of your work. I found it absolutely electric and I was absolutely mesmerized about the things you were doing there. It was absolutely incredible. I mean, I have been aware of the Kekulé experiment and the ring of benzene and everything as well, and making the links to the liminal states and everything else is extremely fascinating. I feel very sad that we've run out of time, because I think we were just starting to really get into something really fascinating there. But I'm sure that Rick and I would be happy to have you back again soon to continue with the theme, because there are so many themes that we can carry through. So I'd just like to say thank you so much for spending 2 hours with us and giving us a glimpse both into your own life and also your research. I mean, it really was fascinating, absolutely fascinating. And all I can say is to the listeners out there, if you want to check out Andreas's books, they are available. You can get them on Amazon. There is also a website. Andreas, can you let the listeners know about the website, where your brother's website, where they can buy the books direct from the site? Have you got the details there?
Yes, give me a second. I'll tell you. Yes, it's here. I just got one of these leaflets that Nikos is putting together. It's www. Thyrsos Press, one word, Thyrsos Press, one word, .co.uk. Would you like a picture? Oh,
good. Okay, that's fine. Now, all I can say is that if you buy one book in your life, what I'd strongly suggest is Travelling Light is a book you will go back to and you will read again and again and again. It is an absolute classic. It's a castanada for our time, and it is just very, very well worth reading, because it's a young man's journey in Greece in the 1960s, and it is simply fascinating. And I would really like to thank our guest Andreas Mavromatis for writing his wonderful books, and I'm really looking forward to working with him in the future, because there's lots of areas of mutual interest that both of us are very keen to talk about and work together about. So thank you again for being involved, and thank you again for joining the Peak Experience. The next Peak Experience at the moment is penciled in for the 13th of May, when we'll have Dr. Daryl Trefford. And Dr. Daryl Trefford was the technical advisor for the movie Rain Man. And Daryl worked very closely with Kim Peek, who was the bassist of the Rain Man, who died tragically around about 18 months ago. So thanks again for joining us on the Peak Experience, and look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm
sorry we didn't have enough time to talk about the hypnagogia. There's much more we can talk about.
Okay, we will do that again, because Andreas, there was so much material there as well, you know, that I felt we were just getting into it. But I'm sure we can put in another hour sometime in the future to just continue with that theme as well, because it fits in so well with the experiences that so many people have. So just really thanks for that. Okay, Andreas, what I will do is I'll ring you in the next couple of days. I'm likely to be in London sometime, I think it's in middle of May. So I'll try and see if I can get to see you then, which would be really good to, because I've been making massive amounts of notes here that I want to talk to you about, like the triune brain, the Paul McLean stuff and everything else. So I'm very, very much wanting to carry that forward. Okay, Rick, how did that go? Did we get everything?
I captured everything locally. I don't know how well it did on live stream, so I'll put it together and post it in a